Welcome again, dear participants. This is a session on communication skills for technical teachers. I am Ramchandra Dhonukshe, lecturer in English, Kusrowadia Institute of Technology. In the previous video, we studied various barriers, how to overcome those barriers to make our communication effective. This video is divided in three parts. The first is principles of effective communication. Then useful tips and guidelines for classroom communication. And the third is general tips and guidelines that will help you to become a good communicator. As I said earlier, there are two ways that help us to make our communication effective. One is to identify and overcome the barriers, and the other one is to follow the principles of communication. In this video, we are going to discuss principles of effective communication. We are going to study these seven important principles of effective communication. Principle of clarity, principle of conciseness, principle of correctness, principle of completeness, principle of feedback, principle of flexibility, and principle of informality. Let's start with principle of clarity. Clarity is essential while communicating to avoid misunderstanding. Make sure there is no ambiguity. Ask right questions for clarity. Let's try to understand this with the help of a case study. Read this conversation between Arpita and her mom. Okay, now the question is Arpita telling the truth? Do you come to know from this conversation that she is not hiding something? Read the conversation again and think about it. Okay. In fact, Arpita said she was with Nikita. She didn't say clearly that she was not with Salma. That is the point. Isn't it possible that she was with both Nikita and Salma and all of them went for a movie? Very cleverly, she avoids mention of Salma because she knows very well her mom doesn't like her. Looking at the choice of her words, one cannot suspect easily whether she is hiding something. We don't know for sure, but imagine if it is true, what a huge mistake it would be. What would be Arpita's reply if her mother had rather asked her a direct question, like who were you with yesterday? There is possibility that she would still tell a lie even after asking a direct question. But if Arpita listens to her conscience, maybe she would tell the truth. But that is not the point here. People usually hide a lot of things from others. The point here is what answer you get depends upon what question you ask. So no matter what, ask the right questions. The next is principle of conciseness. This principle says, keep it short and meaningful. Communicate using least possible words, unless you are writing a story or a novel, of course. Verboseness means unnecessarily lengthy description of something, either irritates your audience and distracts them or creates confusion. The next is principle of correctness. Sometimes we need to include some data like research findings, facts, or information related to our topic. Whenever we include such information, we should make sure that it is correct and authentic. The next is See that whatever you write or speak is free from errors like grammatical errors, spelling errors, etc. Principle of completeness is also important because sometimes due to work pressure or lack of concentration or due to some distraction, we forget to include all the necessary details in our message. Read this draft of a notice. Okay, now imagine you are a student. Read it again and see what questions come to your mind. Well, a student who reads this notice will obviously think, when exactly is the seminar? The time is not mentioned in the notice. To avoid confusion and to make your communication more efficient, you should always see that all the necessary details are included in the message before sending it. Principle of feedback is also very important to make your communication effective. Feedback can be positive or negative. Both help to improve quality of communication. Positive feedback enables the sender to continue with the communication. Negative feedback enables the sender to revisit the communication process and make necessary changes. For example, if the students don't understand a particular topic, the teacher will try to explain it in different words, use different methods, give more questions or exercise for practice, show a model or chart, conduct extra lectures or practical sessions, etc. One should not be afraid of negative feedback. On the other hand, one should thank the audience if one receives negative feedback, because everyone gives positive feedback and you will find only a few people telling you what is wrong with your communication. We should take negative feedback positively and think optimistically. Sometimes we ignore negative feedback. Instead of ignoring, we should take it as a suggestion and think on what changes we can make to address the issue. Hence, negative feedback is actually an opportunity for the sender to improve his communication. As a receiver, it is your duty to give feedback. But you should remember a few things. Giving feedback is an art. Keep your feedback short, specific, and clear. Try to be honest as much as possible while giving feedback. Giving wrong feedback can harm both the sender and the receiver, as well as the communication process. Not giving feedback or giving wrong feedback can harm the performance and reputation of your organization as well. For example, if the people who perform well do not get due attention or appreciation, they get demotivated. Imagine someone is not good at something, but still you say nice things to that person just because you have your personal interest or you want to please that person to gain something. That person who is receiving wrong feedback will continue to make the same mistakes over and over again until someday he will realize himself or somebody else will tell him. Do not forget to give positive feedback first. Tell what is good and how it is beneficial for you. Only after giving positive feedback, you should give negative feedback. But remember, you should not hurt the feelings of the sender. Your feedback should not offend the person. He is not your enemy. Use words carefully and be polite. While you are giving feedback, you should be constructive and polite in your approach. Present negative feedback as suggestions for improvement and not as criticism. For example, instead of saying, "You speak very fast, I don't understand anything," you can say, "I would appreciate it if you speak a little slower." Or you can say, "I think if you speak a little slower, it would be more effective." Or you can also say, "I have a small suggestion for you. I think you should speak a little slower." Instead of saying, "I don't know what you said," you can say, "Actually, I was not paying attention." Or you can also say, "I couldn't get your point. Could you please repeat that? As a sender, always seek feedback. Do not expect or do not wait for the audience to give feedback. You should seek feedback whenever possible, whenever required. You can do it by asking questions, but remember, you should ask the right questions. Ask specific questions to get appropriate feedback. If you ask your students how was the lecture, the students will say it was nice, that's all. Such kind of feedback is of no use. You will not get anything from such feedback. For example, during the lecture, what happens most of the time is we ask the students, have you understood this topic? Everyone says yes. We leave the class happily and think that all is well. You should ask specific questions. For example, imagine you have taught the topic simple machines, and at the end of the lecture or sometimes in the middle, you ask a question, tell me the formula to calculate velocity ratio of pulley block. The students who know the answer should raise their hands. Now you will come to know the fact. You will come to know actually how many students have really understood the topic. Keep 2-3 questions ready. You can ask these questions at the beginning, at the end, or at appropriate time during the lecture. You can start your lecture by asking questions on the topic that you taught in the previous lecture. This is really a good idea, because once the students come to know that you always ask specific questions on the previous lecture, they will probably study more and study regularly. Now let's look at the principle of flexibility. This principle says, change with the changing time. I hope you know what happens if we refuse to change ourselves with time. Adopt and adapt to the new technology. You know what happened to the organizations and the people who didn't adopt new things? If you keep on complaining or giving excuses like, I don't know how to use the smartphone, I don't know how to send an email, I don't know the features in this application, I cannot operate this software, etc. Maybe you will save yourself from responsibilities, but your inner self, your conscience will never forgive you. Somebody has rightly said, don't change yourself because you're afraid of what people think. Change yourself because you want to be better. The next principle is principle of informality. We must use formal language at the workplace. We should follow the rules and regulations of the organization. We should practice social ethics and code of conduct, be respectful, cooperative and supportive. We should never peep into others' personal life unnecessarily. We should use formal language and behave formally. But there's another side that we should never forget. Even though formal communication is necessary, only formal communication is not sufficient. We should also have some informal relations with our colleagues, team members, seniors, and especially with the juniors. We should not forget that we all are human beings. We are not robots. Our life is incomplete without our feelings and emotions. We should sometimes talk about each other's personal life. Along with doing our office work sincerely and efficiently, we should share and care for each other. That is how an organization is built in a strong and homogeneous bond. And such an organization makes progress. No organization can be run smoothly and effectively without having a component of informal communication. Without this informal communication, your office will become a boring place. People will lose their enthusiasm. There is one more drawback of having only formal relations with the people in your organization, and that is, it leads to VIP culture. People do not work with dedication. They do not give their 100%. Too much informal relation also leads to a casual approach. People take everything very lightly. People tend to spend a lot of time gossiping, thereby wasting time and resources. Hence, both being too formal and being too informal are harmful. You must try to strike a balance. There should be a blend of formal and informal communication in an organization. Here are some useful tips and guidelines for classroom communication. Make sure you keep an average rate of speech. Too slow speech leads to boredom, distraction, and the audience loses interest. If you speak too fast, it makes a negative impact. Fast speaking is usually interpreted as a sign of nervousness and lack of confidence. Especially if you are not trained to speak faster, it lands you in trouble. Because lack of coordination between your brain and your speech organs leads to mispronunciation and dropping important words. You should practice taking meaningful and deliberate pauses. Take a short break of 2 to 3 minutes a couple of times during your lecture. Because if you speak continuously for a long time, saliva comes out of your mouth while speaking. It's natural. Here's a small tip on how to take a short break during your lecture. Give an activity to the students. Design the activity so that it should be completed in 2 to 3 minutes, not more than that, so that it doesn't waste your much of your time. There are two benefits of doing this. First is you get a break, and the second is students don't get bored due to that small change. Take a sip of water a couple of times during your lecture. I have seen many presenters doing this. This helps you to keep your body hydrated. Moreover, this lubricates your throat, saving you from the troubles of dry throat. If you speak with a dry throat for a long time, medical complications can arise like sore throat and inflammation. These are common among the people in the teaching profession. There might not be any immediate or noticeable implication, but the symptoms of this show after a long time. It is always a good idea to take a small water bottle with you when you go to your class. Then use relevant anecdotes, examples, stories, quotes, wherever applicable. This helps you to increase the interest of the audience and keep them engaged. Try to remember students' names and say their names while you are talking to them, especially their first name. Remembering names is not easy because we have to deal with many students, and the students are not with us the whole day and throughout the week like in primary school. No matter what, we can at least try and remember the names. I was not good at it, but recently I have been trying this, and believe me, it makes a huge difference. Always start on a positive note. Always start your lecture on a positive note. Speak something positive, your experience or anything. This helps the students to become attentive and receptive. Your initial few sentences decide the direction of your whole lecture. How you begin gives an idea of how it will go. So always start on a positive note. All right, now here are some general tips and guidelines for you. The first is pronounce people's names correctly. The world famous motivational speaker and writer Dale Carnegie says, "The sweetest sound in the world is the person's own name." So make sure you have understood the person's name correctly. If you don't pronounce people's names correctly, they feel insulted. Make sure people understand your name correctly. If you don't tell your name properly, it is your mistake. People usually find uncommon or unusual names difficult. In such cases, you can write your name and show. Sometimes writing names in English can lead to more than one pronunciation. For example, S-A-M can be pronounced as Sam or Sam. Like K-A-M-A-L can be pronounced as Kamal or Kamal. In such cases, you can have your name written in Devanagari script like I do. Many times, people find it difficult to get the correct pronunciation of my surname. Some people call me Dhanuske, some people say Dhonuske. So, wherever possible, I write my name both in English as well as in Devanagari script, as it is on the welcome slide of this presentation. Don't start your introduction with the word myself. Instead of saying myself Ramchandra Dhonukshe, you can say I am or my name is. The next important thing is read before you send. This is applicable to email, SMS, social messaging like Facebook, Insta, WhatsApp, etc. Many people avoid proofreading because it is tiresome and time consuming. Sometimes we send our messages before reading because we don't have time. Don't do this. Never send a message without proofreading. This might seem like a simple thing, but if you follow this, you can save yourself from big troubles. Whenever you want to click on that send or post button, just tell yourself not to do it before reading once again. Some people have a habit of typing a message in a language other than English by using English alphabets. My suggestion is, as far as possible, try to avoid such things. Look at this message. Such type of text doesn't serve the purpose and it takes too much time to read and understand. The next point is, use technology for your benefit. Try to save time. Learn different tricks that help you to operate your gadgets faster. It is difficult to catch up with the speed of today's generation, but at least we can try. For example, if you have to send an email of say 4 to 5 sentences, how much time you need to type the message? Is it easy or difficult? Is it time consuming for you? Or you can do it really quickly? Nowadays, everyone uses WhatsApp. Ask yourself how much time you spend typing a message on WhatsApp. Let me tell you, nowadays on smartphones, nobody types the messages with the help of a keyboard. There is a facility for voice typing on smartphones. It is also called speech to text. Just hold your phone near your mouth and speak. Your work is done. You can make use of such facilities and save time and efforts both to a greater extent. Even local languages like Marathi and Hindi have support for this feature. And you can easily type such messages in your own script. The coordinators will take your feedback, no doubt, but I want to request that if you think there is any scope for improvement, do not hesitate to tell me. Your valuable suggestions will help me to improve myself. You can write me on rbdcwitpune@gmail.com. Don't worry, I will take your suggestions positively. Now we are going to take a review of what we have learnt in this video. Be clear in your speech and writing. There shouldn't be any ambiguity. Be concise and meaningful. Present correct information. Keep your writing free from errors. Provide all the necessary details. Giving feedback is an art. Be honest, polite, and specific while giving feedback. Start with positive feedback. Give negative feedback as a suggestion. Do not criticize, be constructive in your approach. As a sender, ask right questions to get right feedback. Be flexible, change with changing time. Adopt and adapt to the new technology. Strike a balance between formal and informal communication. Avoid speaking too fast or too slow. Ask direct and specific questions if you want to know the fact. Sip water frequently. Take a short break of 2 to 3 minutes once or twice during your lecture. Give a small activity to the students. Pronounce people's names correctly. Read carefully before sending an email or a message. Use technology to save time and efforts.